He is the son of a political powerhouse here in South Carolina and beyond. And in this edition of Quintin's Close-Ups, I talk exclusively with Thomas Ravenel.
Mr. Ravenel, a lot of Charlestonians haven't seen you in a while.
Yeah.
Tell me, how are you?
I'm doing great, Quentin.
Yes.
Fantastic.
That is awesome. And you know, I had the blessing of meeting and interviewing your father in 2011.
Uh-huh.
Tell me, how is he?
He's doing good. He will be 86 this month, March 29th.
Wow. That's awesome.
In fact, the reason I'm in Charleston, I just attended my mother's birthday party. She just turned 84.
Really? Mm-hmm. That is awesome.
She's born 29. My dad was born 27.
Wow. That is good.
Both in March.
Yes. Mm-hmm. That's amazing, too. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, recently you made a lot of headlines because there were some rumors spread that you actually were interested in running for Tim Scott's vacant U.S. House seat.
That's right.
But you quickly dispelled those rumors on Facebook.
That's right.
Talk to me about why you came to the conclusion of no.
Well, there were just too many people in the race. I just thought, you know, there were people just coming out of the woodwork.
Yeah.
And if I were to run, I'd want to have an opportunity and a platform to enunciate in detail my various positions. And unlike Sanford, they said, you know, how has your downfall affected you? And I like Mark. I'm probably going to support him. And he said it gave him more empathy, but with respect to government policy,
yes,
he had made no changes. He said convictions are convictions. I don't know if that's a statement I would use, given my conviction, but my criminal conviction. But, you know, on a number of issues, I would want an opportunity to say, you know, where I've changed, you know, on a number of issues. You know, I feel like having gone through my downfall, so to speak, it's sort of emancipated me from a lot of Republican dogma. I mean, for example, immigration. I'm very pro-immigration. I think a lot of Republicans conflate their fear of immigration more has to do with problems with welfare.
Okay.
And they conflate the two. But the truth is that immigrants of this country aren't eligible for welfare. They're eligible for medical attention if they're bleeding and they enter a hospital room.
Okay.
And immigration is, you know, it helps the economy.
Sure.
You know, as Mexicans move in, Americans move up. You know, we need a labor force in this country. So that's one issue. The other issue is gay rights. You know, my support for gay rights is consistent with my support for individual liberty and limited government. I think a lot of Republicans are silenced and intimidated by strident, loud, hateful voices from religious right leaders. And I think my position is the right position, and politically it's a smart position.
Okay.
So that's an issue. Also, the war on drugs. I think it's unconstitutional. Were I to run again, I would not go on an apology tour. I don't feel like what I did was wrong. I think these laws are wrong. And if I may say, they're racist.
Okay.
They can't put everybody in prison, so they pick and choose.
Yes.
Abe Lincoln said that the best way to have a bad law repealed is strictly enforce it. They were to strictly enforce it and put 80% of the population over the age of 47 in prison. There would quickly be calls to repeal this insane policy. You know, you got to take a look at history, and I've studied history.
Sure.
500 years ago, a guy by the name of John Locke, he basically the godfather of the philosophical underpinnings of our founding documents. And the issue at the time was religious freedom. You know, it's all about the freedom principle. You know, right now they say, well, we can't legalize drugs because everybody go out and become a drug addict. Well, back in the time, they didn't allow religious freedom because the conventional wisdom at the time was, well, we can't let people decide their own religion. They'll all pick the wrong religion and we'll all go to hell. I mean, that was the mindset back then. And it was just widely accepted. You know, without a coercive religious authority,
sure,
society would dissolve into chaos and into disorder. And he rightly pointed out that the real disturbers of the peace were those who were intolerant.
Okay.
And I think it's sort of ironic today those on the religious right, those who benefited the most from social tolerance are the ones who are the most intolerant.
Okay.
So a lot of my change has just come about through study. You know, there's always this thing, it's a phrase, it's called cognitive dissonance. You know what that is? When you hear two opposing viewpoints, you know, for example, Republicans, we're for limited government, but we want a government big enough to look into a person's heart and tell them who they can love.
Okay.
You understand the cognitive, that,
sure.
Doesn't,
absolutely.
That doesn't make any sense. We're for limited government, but we want a government big enough to pry into your personal space and tell you what you can put into your own body. I mean, the whole purpose of our government is to, we the people institute a government to secure our rights, life, what is it?
Liberty.
Life, liberty, pursuit of happiness. Pursuit of happiness is you as an individual determine it, not as it's dictated to you by the state, regardless of your race, regardless of your religion, your creed, your gender, and hypothetically, I would say your sexual orientation. Why is that such a radical thing? You know, the government's here to secure our rights against other people, those who would violate our rights through force or fraud.
Okay.
We didn't fight an empire across the ocean, you know, this king, so that we could have a government to protect us from ourselves. You know, so I see this, it's a theme in how my philosophy's changed. You know, say what you will about the teetotalers. I mean, they respected the Constitution. They went through a constitutional amendment process. Granted, it was very stupid policy. It's the only constitutional amendment that's ever been repealed. But the current drug war, they didn't pass, they didn't go through this constitutional amendment process. They started passing laws. Back in the day, they passed constitutional amendment. The enabling legislation was the Volstead Act, which prohibited the sale and the manufacturing of alcohol.
Yeah.
You know, today's prohibition is far worse. Back then, just the sellers and distributors of the alcohol were, you know, received criminal penalties. Now, mere users did not go to jail. Today, they put mere users of drugs in jail. And then, you know, and I don't have a problem. I did my time. You know, it was 10 months, 6 months. I was in a federal prison, but...
Talk to me about that. What was it like?
Well, here's what I have a problem with. I would have done 4 years, 5 years.
Okay.
Just tell me what the sentence is. You know, I can pay my debt to society, but in our system, you're never done. Ever.
Okay.
I will never fully pay my debt to society. You know, they say you got 10 miles to pay this debt. So no. Once you're quote-unquote set free, you then enter this legal purgatory where the right to borrow money, to vote, to defend yourself. I live out in the country. I can't own a gun. Forever denied me. I can't even vote in this congressional race.
Oh.
You know, and then if you receive any kind of government benefits, you cannot, not that I'm for that, but I don't think you should be denied that. I think if you pay your debt to society, you should have paid it, and then you should be restored your constitutional rights.
Okay.
But not in this country. And we incarcerate 5 times the world rate. In this country, we incarcerate black people 5 times the rate they did during the height of apartheid in South Africa. But yet we went and lectured that country. We incarcerate 8 times the rate of Canada. Now, are we safer? I mean, ostensibly, we're locking up all these people.
Okay.
We got to be safer. But we're the 80th safest country on the planet. Canada, which incarcerates at 1/8 the rate we do, they are, they're like the 8th safest country.
Wow.
And so, America, with these ignominious incarceration rates, are we safer? No. But it gets back, you know, to this freedom principle. You know, I would argue that if you really want people to be more moral, treat individual adults as adults. And with respect to drugs, you know, what happens when you treat adults like adults, they may engage and they may experiment with drugs, engage in a learning process, learn from the consequences of their behavior, and they end up making better, more moral decisions. Take Amsterdam. Pot's legal. They treat people like adults. Try it at your own risk. They use drugs half the rate we do. It's legal. You know, so I think that you treat people like adults, and people may, and that's what this country's, you know, our prosperity is based on our freedom. People have to be free to choose to make their own decisions, and when we get away from that, you know, we've got 20,000 drug gangs in this country. I mean, drugs are bad, but prohibition, it's much worse. We learned this back in the 20s.
Okay.
But, you know, I don't want to dwell on that, but, you know, prison, it wasn't that tough for me, you know. I spent a lot of time reading.
Your father said you had a lot of sense of humor there, too.
Yeah, you know, I didn't realize how bad it was until I got out and realized that, okay, you know, for example, as a real estate developer, I made my living borrowing money. I borrowed a lot of money, and I go out and develop property. I couldn't borrow any more money. You know, banks, I've had to put three of my shopping centers into my sister's name, and it seems absurd to me. She's got a fraction of my net worth, a fraction of my experience. I don't see how the, I've done 70 projects in 10 states. I've never missed a payment. I've never had a real estate workout like Donald Trump. I've never had a default. I've never had a bankruptcy. But they're not going to lend money to me because it is felony conviction, even though most people I know have done drugs. But yet, because of this conviction, they're going to hold that against me forever.
Well, you know, we know your stance on politics. Yeah. Let's talk about you. You know, understand, let's revisit memory lane. Mm-hmm. I understand that you were the youngest of six children. Tell me, how did you stand up?
As the youngest of six, you know, it's sort of a misnomer. I was basically an only child. I mean, I have a brother, my next normal brother, I say normal, I have a brother who's Down syndrome.
Syndrome William.
And he's 3.5 years older than me. My next normal normal sibling was 7 years older. So by the time I came of age, age 10, 11,
okay,
everybody was gone.
Wow.
In fact, my father was gone. My parents divorced when I was 10. They separated at age 10. 1 year later, my sister left. My brother went to an institution.
Yes.
And then my mother went to work.
Right.
So I was in this big house, all by myself, sort of a latchkey kid. Yeah, I saw my father on the weekend. We have a good relationship, but you know this whole concept that, you know, big loving family, and that was true for, you know, up until I was 10.
Okay.
Father left, mom went to work, everyone went off to sister's college. You know, my brother and my sister. Oldest, they got married, and my sister Renee, Eva, they were in college. William was he's Down syndrome, right. He was in a group home.
Right.
So,
how did you deal with that?
It was tough, you know, losing all these people.
Yeah.
One by one, everybody started leaving, and it was traumatic, you know, as a kid. You know, you're losing your parents, you know, effectively. Your mom not being there,
right.
Dad leaving. It had an effect on me. And, you know, to this day, I'm, you know, single, not married, you know, but had problems with, you know, commitments.
Well, let's talk about St. Andrew's High School. Who was Thomas Ravenel as a high school student?
I was not a very good student. Okay. I took advanced courses, some advanced courses.
Oh, good.
Smart student.
You.
I was not a studious student.
Okay.
You know, I was the type of guy that I would do my homework before I left school. I never wanted to be burdened with a sack of books.
Me too.
Leaving every day. I was like, yeah, I would try to do my homework, and I would leave every day and unburden by a book bag. But I was a dedicated athlete. I was, I was just mentioning, you tore up this knee at your alma mater, Stonyfield.
Right.
You know, I was captain of my wrestling team, captain of the football team. In fact, my junior year, I was lower state champ in wrestling. I was second in the state. But I lost to this guy who had been a runner-up. The guy that beat me for the state championship had been a runner-up 3 years in a row.
Wow.
No, 2 years in a row. So this was his third year in the finals. Sure. And he was determined to beat me. I think I could have beaten him, but I figured I went in my senior year, but I tore up my knee senior year in football and did not get the opportunity to return and wrestle my senior year. And that was disappointing at the time. Then I went to Citadel.
Yeah, let's talk about the Citadel. Where you major in business administration.
I was major in business administration. I was on the wrestling team there. Right. I did well.
Yes.
I did extremely well there my freshman year. Then I started having troubles with the knee. But I wrestled my sophomore and junior year. My senior year, I just finally had to give it up. You know, this knee was it was just a handicap for me.
Sure. And, you know, once I read, too, that after you left the Citadel in 1985, you took on a couple of jobs. A carpenter, handyman, lawnmower, painter, and landscaper. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering, where did you get that hard work ethic from?
Well, when I was a kid, you know, in high school and in college, I always worked. In fact, and I can say this now, but I used to sneak out of the Citadel and work.
Oh, is that right?
I jumped the fence. You weren't even supposed to have a car. I had a car parked outside, and in the afternoons, I had the job.
Oh, wow.
I went to Citadel my 9th year. You weren't supposed to leave the campus.
Wow, yeah.
I would jump that fence, and I would go, and I would work.
Yes.
And, you know, now you think back, what was I thinking?
Yeah.
I said, I'm not going to stop working.
Right.
And during furloughs, you know, Thanksgiving, Christmas, I mean, that's vacation. I worked the whole time. I got up 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock in the morning, worked all day long, all during Christmas, all during, so, you know, my father was raised during the Depression,
sure.
And my household, you got up and you worked. And I'm not
a lazy guy.
I was taught, you know, I think I'm lazy because, you know, I think I could do more, you know, I could. But somebody was telling me the other day that I was the least lazy person they knew. I dated this girl, and she's like, you know, she was telling me about her husband, and I said, well, how are we doing? She said, you know, most people, you know, I'd get up in the morning, you know, motivated, you know.
But you did it.
You know, I'm sitting here slumping, and people look at me, my demeanor's lazy. But I'm not really lazy, I'm slouching.
Yeah, you worked so hard, you know.
I just, you know, and, you know, the irony in life is those who are lazy end up having to work very hard. And those who are not lazy, they put themselves in a position where they can be lazy. You know, I don't have to work anymore.
That's true.
You know, I do work.
Right.
But not so much in business, like I say. I mean, my career. You know,
yeah.
You know, the economy, coupled with the fact that I can't borrow money. Yeah, I can borrow money, but I'm always paying a higher rate. I'm getting you know, bad treatment from the banks. But I'm not. Why should I cry? I've obviously done well. I've been blessed. I'm lucky.
Yes.
And I just see the system as something we need to change in America.
Speaking of politics, you later ran for the state house at one point, right after graduating from college. Is that right?
In '88, I ran for the House of Representatives.
Yeah.
And was edged out by a guy named Stuart Barnwell, who's now deceased.
Okay.
Stuart died of cancer.
Oh, no.
Back in '90, but he went on to defeat at the hands of Jimmy Bailey. He was a Democratic nominee.
Right.
And then I got back into politics 2004, ran for the U.S. Senate.
Senate, right? Yeah. And now let's talk about you borrowing money from your father. I understand you had to do it to get an MBA from the University of South Carolina.
Well, yeah, I decided I'd saved enough money to go back in '89 and get my MBA.
Okay.
And then after the first year, I got a job offer up in D.C., worked for a big developer.
Oh, great.
And I remember talking to my father, who was on vacation at the time. He was in Hawaii. He was also a member of Congress. He was in Hawaii.
Right.
And I said, I think I'm going to take this job. And it was kind of odd at the time. I couldn't borrow any money. I couldn't get a student loan. And I owed a lot of money in taxes because I'd done well.
Yeah.
And they said they wouldn't lend me money because, you know, I'd be the ideal person to lend money to. They said, no, you made too much money. They were lending money to people who
really
who didn't have a history of being able to pay him back, because it was a government deal.
Sure.
Oh, you make too much money. So anyway, I told my father, I said, look, I'm not going to go back to school. I need to go back to work. I'm going to take this job. And he said, Thomas, I will lend you the money. You need to finish, get that degree.
Yeah.
And so he lent me, I don't know, it was $5,000, whatever it was.
Yeah.
And this is back in 90. This was after we invaded Iraq, because Iraq had just invaded Kuwait.
Right.
And the stock, and I had some money, well, little money I did have. I was tied up in the stock market, of course. And I saw, you know, a lot of my savings, you know, evaporate literally overnight. And that together with, you know, I had to pay the tax bill, and I just said, told my father, look, I'm going to, you know, take this job, and it was up in D.C., it was right. Exciting living up there. And yeah, he said, no, yeah. we'll lend you the money. And so he did lend me some money, but, you know, it wasn't much, and I paid him back, it's no big deal.
And then after you got your MBA from the University of South Carolina in 1991, you created Ravenel Development Corporation.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. I'm thinking, where did that vision come from?
You know, they say, you know, in business school, they told us that, you know, it was a question the professor asked, you know, what is the biggest determinant of whether someone's going to be successful or not? You know, is it brains? Was it work ethic? Was it, you know, just,
yeah.
It go down the list, and and nobody could answer the question. He said, the biggest determinant is your parents. Said, you know, you see somebody who's successful, you model their behavior.
Yes.
So as a kid, you know, I watched my father. He was a businessman, had a number of companies, right. He was a real estate developer, and he's an active investor
right.
in various companies. And so you just come by naturally. You know, you see that person, you model that behavior, you don't think it's anything strange to start your company. You know, you just do it. You know, it happens. There's no central plan. It just happens naturally.
Yes.
It was just the natural course of things for me. Of course, I was gonna go and do what I did. I modeled that behavior from my father. He's very, very extremely successful,
right.
And financially, professionally, and in his personal life too.
Sure.
You know, six kids. He's married to my mom 24 years, and then that didn't work out. But his second wife, he's been married, I think, about 35, maybe, I don't know, he was married, Rick, in 74.
Okay.
So that's almost 40 years.
Yeah, I was going to say.
So he's been married to wives over 60 years. So. Yeah, so I modeled his behavior in business, and I think that's it. You know, and the odd thing was that I really had to leave Charlotte. People think, well, he's a Ravenel, you know, he's born with a silver spoon and all this. I went to Atlanta, Georgia. Nobody. I remember constantly having to spell my name. R-A-V. People thought I was having V. No, V is in victory. Nobody knew the Ravenel name, and that's where my career took off.
Oh, okay.
And I was very enthusiastic, very energetic, and we developed a lot of different projects in 10 different states.
Yes.
You know, 70 projects, 10 different states. And I had a lot of success, and then it was only after I had a lot of success that I came back to Charleston. You know, so if I'd have stayed in Atlanta, I mean, that's what happens. I think a lot of people go to these growing markets.
Yeah.
A lot of you know, our best and brightest, you know, they leave, unfortunately, South Carolina, because the opportunity is just not, there's not as much here. I wish we had more industry here. I wish it was. We had more growth here, but a lot of people leave and they go to New York City, or they go to Washington, Atlanta.
Yeah.
Or they go to these big, fast, emerging. Yeah, at the time Atlanta was booming.
Yeah.
Well, so yes. I went there, and I remember I was doing developments with this guy, and he said, well, we need someone to go do the Atlanta market. And I said, oh, really? And so he tells the story. I never even thought second. You know, I never thought about it. You know, in a retrospective way. He told a story. He said, yeah, I talked to you on a Friday, and I told you I needed someone to do deals on Friday. Monday, I called you, and he said, you'd already rent an apartment. Well, it was actually a house. I rented a house in Atlanta. And so, I mean, I got my U-Haul. I, you know, got a trailer and hooked up the car,
right.
The U-Haul.
Up I-26.
I was gone. And I remember they put a governor on this U-Haul. I can only go about 50 miles an hour.
Oh, goodness.
And so I thought I was going to get there about 11 p.m. I got there maybe 3 in the morning. And then I spent the next 3 hours unloading, and there was no electricity in the house. Everything's pitch black. I'm moving everything in there by myself. I got a desk and was like dragging it in there.
I hope it was the summer.
Yeah, so everything was unloaded at 6 a.m. Yeah, it was the summer.
Okay.
6 a.m.
Okay.
And then I have my bed there. I crashed till like 9.
Yeah.
And then I recommenced the setting everything up. And you know, by, I don't know, noon that day, everything was moved in. I was ready to go to work.
Yes.
Of course, I went straight to work.
Yeah.
And those were good days.
Yeah, I bet they were. Well, you know, describe to me the following one word. Politics.
Mm.
Just one word.
Fun.
South Carolina.
Dangerous.
Real estate.
One word. It's hard to describe that one word.
That's fine.
One word to describe real estate.
Yeah.
Success.
Yes. Polo.
Polo. That's how the Argentines say it.
Really?
The L's lazy.
Okay, okay. Yeah.
I say polo. Polo. I play polo. Polo is adrenaline.
Yes. Boating.
Adrenaline. Boating?
Yeah.
Casualness.
Thomas Ravenel.
Complicated.
Well, listen, I know that we all know this too, but you have, you know, basically overcome a lot of demons in your life over the past couple of years.
Mm-hmm.
As we sit here right now, are you at peace?
No, I don't think so.
Okay.
I think I'm a little restless. Okay. I'm wrestling with, you know, what I want to do with my life. I'm still single. I would like to get married, have kids.
Yeah.
I would like to bring certain issues to the discussion.
Sure.
In Republican politics.
Okay.
Because I think they're important. You know, whether it's immigration, whether it's individual liberty, whether it's peace. Yeah, I think there's a lot of things the country's doing wrong, and I think there's, I don't think the Republican Party is being true to the founding principles of this country. I think it's been corrupted, as has the Democratic Party. George Washington said, you know, the ruination of this country, or this republic, will be, at the time they call it factionalism.
Okay.
Which is, that's, I mean, in modern parlance, that would be the political parties.
Okay.
I mean, the Democratic Party, to get the nomination, you have to be in lockstep with whatever the unions want. And I think they've ruined public education in this country. The Republican Party, you have to be in lockstep with the nativists. People want to keep immigrants out. That's bad for the economy. Or you have to be anti-this, anti-gay. You have to be militaristic. You know, let's go invade more countries. Let's have more and more military bases. I call them Republican Keynesianism, you know, Keynesiasts. You know, the people that, you know, Republicans, when it comes to social welfare programs, they say, well, that's Keynesianism. You know, you can't go out there and just throw money at problems and think you're going to spur the economy. But when it comes to the military, they say, well, you know, cognitive dissonance.
Okay.
It doesn't work. You know, just to say we're going to go out there and we're going to build military bases all over the world, how does that make us more a country at peace? You know, it's like we're sticking our finger in the eyes of various state actors around the planet.
Okay.
You know, de Tocqueville came over here in 1830, and he said, you know, America's doing great. We're involved in commerce. You know, we're trading with the rest of the world. We're engaged in diplomacy. Unlike at the time, the big empires were Spain, France, England. They were bankrupting their coffers by being at war with the world.
Okay.
You know, their militaries were all over the globe, and we weren't We weren't interested in that. We were busy growing and building this country. At the end of the 1800s, we had the largest economy in the world. You know, think about that, a country 100 years old. Right. What are we doing now? We've got, you know, we got 100, we're in 130 different countries, 900 military bases. The military-industrial complex has co-opted the Republican Party. You see John McCain, Lindsey Graham, they're constantly over in Iraq, and they're agitating to get involved in Syria, or they want, you know, they want us to get involved in Egypt and the Arab Spring, it would surprise me. I mean, they're always talking about, you know, moving into Iran, you know, invading yet the third Muslim country in 10 years.
Okay.
So I just see that there's problems with both of these political parties. And I think the Republicans need to be honest about their own party if they want to occupy the high ground, and then from which they can then attack, say, the obvious problems I see with the Democratic Party. I mean, you got to sort of mend your own fences first before you start criticizing the fences of your neighbor.
You were once a rising star in politics.
Uh-huh.
As you put on your thinking hat and you look into your crystal ball, do you see yourself rising again?
I don't know. You know, I wouldn't mind, you know, having a dialogue with in a public forum like this. And I appreciate this opportunity, Quintin,
exactly.
To see if any of this resonates with the American people, the freedom issue, you know, the liberty issue, and be consistent. You know, take freedom of speech. You know, we have the freedom of speech not to protect our right to talk about the weather. Talk about something you may find totally egregious, but some famous patriot, I don't know which one, said it. You know, we may disagree, but I'll defend to the death your right to disagree with me. And that's the way I see a lot of different things. You have to, you know, libertarianism, and I consider myself a libertarian, and I think it's a label that's gaining value. I think conservative is a label that's sort of is depreciating in value.
Okay.
Because it doesn't mean anything. You know, what was big government conservatism under Bush? We doubled the debt, you know. So all libertarianism is that, you know, we're going to allow individual adults to make the major decisions in their life and not relegate those decisions to a group of elites in some foreign distant capital. You know, Hayek talked about the fatal conceit that a handful of people can better to make decisions for hundreds of millions of Americans. You know, there's 300 million Americans that are making billions of decisions, all in their mutual self-interest. I think that's, you know, it's called spontaneous order. You know, it's this thought process that things happen naturally, not as a result of a central plan, you know, from languages to law to the economy. You know, it just happens naturally. You know, you don't want to have central planning. You know, because, I mean, take healthcare in this country. You know, they're setting prices, you know, so they underprice some services and they overprice others. So if they overprice something, you know, they're trying to shove those out the door to you because they're getting paid more. And if something's underpriced, you know, you've got long lines now. So nobody, you have to get all the central planning and allow the free market to work. And what that does is that drives down costs and it drives up quality. We get better and better. I mean, take a look at your flip phone there.
Yeah.
You know, that's amazing. I mean, you can buy these things. I mean, think if the government had gotten involved in cell phones.
Yeah.
You know, right now it's a necessity. But 20, 30 years ago, this was a luxury. Only the wealthy owned these things. But the government said, you know, we need to have everyone have a cell phone. So we're going to say this is, thank goodness they said it wasn't a necessity and it was a luxury. If they decided this had been a necessity, our debt would be twice what it is. And then everybody would be carrying around these big bag phones like they did back in the 70s and 80s, not 70s, in the 80s. And we'd be bankrupt. But, you know, they stayed out of it. And guess what? You know, the poorest kid in Guatemala owns a cell phone. This thing has lifted millions of people out of poverty.
Sure.
Because of the free market. They're constantly driving the cost down. They're constantly driving the quality up. You have fishermen down the Caribbean, instead of wasting precious gas going around fishing, they call the market. They still selling fish? No. Okay, they come in. Instead of wasting gas, but you know, catching a bunch of fish that would then die at market and rot. You follow me? I mean, I could take that and expand that to a lot of different things. That's just one example how cell phones have lifted millions of people out of poverty. And it's because the government stayed out of it. And as a result, you know, the poorest kid in China could afford a cell phone, whereas 30 years ago, you know, the richest man in the world, he had a cell phone that was like a fraction as good as the kid cell phone in China. And, I mean, now they're smartphones. That's the beauty of the free market. And, but sometimes it's hard to sell that. And, so, you know, and that's a typical Republican position. We believe in the market. Okay. We believe in less government intervention. But we need to be consistent with that. Say, we need that also in your private life. You know, libertarianism is a minimal government that wants to keep the government out of both the boardrooms and the bedrooms. And, you know, and I could expand on that theory, you know, at length.
I know you could.
But.
So for those people who have counted you out, what is your message to them?
Stay tuned, I guess.
Yes. Thomas Ravenel, it was so great talking to you.
Yeah, appreciate it.
Thank you,
sir. Thanks for dropping by.
Anytime.